Hi everyone, I'm Konstantinos. Actually my background is on the cryptography sector. My PhD was on bilinear pairing and identity-based encryption. In fact, time-release encryption. I joined R3 1.5 years ago, and I'm working on the cryptographic aspects for DLTs, and practically Corda is an open source blockchain for the finance sector. I mean, initially for the finance sector, but now there are so many entities interested in permissioned blockchains, so we have broadened all of our client, let's say, agreements. At the moment, there are at least 200 plus, I would say, leading institutions forming this ecosystem, mainly banks, insurance companies, now Intel and Microsoft are doing some work around our key management or SGX technology that we use. And in this presentation, actually, I will go to a completely different direction. I will say, how did we use to have these zero-knowledge proofs without zero-knowledge proof protocols by using SGX, like some black boxes that do operations, and we don't know what's happening inside, but we know it runs the correct smart contract. And by permission, I mean there is a consensus. There are some entities that form a cluster, and all of the transactions go through there. It's timestamp, it's checked for double spending, and we have two notions of these entities called notaries. Let's call it a notary cluster that signs the transactions. One is non-validating, and the other is validating. By non-validating means all the transactions are timestamped, but the notaries can see nothing about the contents of the transaction. And because it's permissioned and it's a peer-to-peer connection between the nodes, the transactions themselves are not broadcasted to everyone. So it's only the transactional flow, the flows of transactions only between the parties that are transacting. And then when you send something to another entity, you need to send the path of the previous transactions to this entity, and we'll do all the verifications. This has a couple of, let's say, advantages. One of them is GDPR. So your data is not everywhere now. It's only stored on the nodes that are required to have access to this data. And some other things, like, for example, we have this cryptographic agility. And to tell you the truth, because I had a couple of conversations with multiple banks and multiple clients outside the finance sector, there is, especially now with the need to work on the post-quantum cryptography and all of this stuff, there are some requirements that the keys that I want to use shouldn't be CDSA or EDDSA or RSA because, for example, you have a mortgage or a loan that will last for 30 years. I cannot have something that can be spent, I don't know, in 10 years or 15 years when a quantum computer appears. However, this transaction is happening now and it will be valid for too many years that, I don't know, maybe some of the keys will be compromised. And at the moment, we support 5 algorithms, which is EDDSA, CDSA with multiple curves, Sphinx, which is a post-quantum algorithm that we're using, and RSA for backwards compatibility. And eventually, I don't know why, but a lot of people are trying to use a belts and braces approach. So they use composite keys, and they have one RSA key, one ECDSA key, one Sphinx key, and they sign with all of the keys a transaction. So if one of them breaks, then we're still secure if we have, for example, a threshold scheme, like 2 out of 3. So when we started working on this kind of stuff, especially for privacy and some cryptographic features, we had to evaluate so many different techniques out there. And one was zero knowledge proofs. Imagine that R3 was created in 2016. And at that time, it was only, I don't know, maybe Zcash that used zero knowledge proof in practice. And the problems we have sometimes when we're speaking to clients and banks is that it's not always possible to go through and use the product if it's not standardized by FIPS or someone else. And it's true that there is no standardization even for the pairing-friendly curves here, and this sometimes causes problems. And so we cannot always use zero-knowledge proofs. And then we have some other options like multi-party computation, so ring signatures, some homomorphic encryption. We use a lot Merkle trees and tear-offs over the Merkle trees, like partial Merkle trees, some mixing protocols, because it's also the IP that matters. It's not only the cryptographic aspect of not knowing who is behind an address, but we have to hide somehow the sender itself. And we use some graph pruning. So as I said before, because transactions are sent between the parties that were actually involved in the previous paths, where I mean, sometimes we are doing some graph pruning, so there is no any trace to the transactions before. Eventually, we had to choose, that's the main problem, between zero knowledge proofs and secure enclaves with SGX. Why secure enclaves? I will explain why we do it now, and we have some proof of concept with secure enclaves, SGX, I mean the Intel technology, and why we didn't pick zero knowledge proofs at that time. However, we're very open on using zero knowledge proofs, and I will explain how, what is our plan to do so. So imagine Cordas being a system that previously managed to solve the problem of privacy with an indirect way. So it's not mathematically proven that this is a zero knowledge proof. However, we prove by definition of a black box doing something that you know it runs correctly, and there is a proof for this one. And eventually we have to go into a mathematical way of proving things. And some of the problems is smart contract size. So it's not so easy to convince people from the banks to write smart contracts that are zero knowledge proof secure. They write code as we write as developers, and they cannot know what is a witness, what is an auxiliary value, what is everything. So we're missing, what we're missing is a green button that, as I said to Jonathan yesterday, so you're writing Java or C or Go, you press the button, this is converted to SSA, for example, from the compiler. After that, this is converted to R1CS, and then somehow you get the proof. And the problem is you cannot have an arbitrary code sometimes of consisting of many classes, and you can ensure that this will be, I mean, quick enough or fast enough or supported by the underlying curve. Maybe the gates are so many that you cannot have a proof for this one. So our vision eventually was to create a JVM, because we're working with JVM languages, that is zero knowledge proof by itself. I mean, everything that you write there will be zero knowledge proof. So what we're waiting for this event, for this workshop, is somehow to formalize, standardize some aspects for zero knowledge proofs, and especially the settings, so we can use them in turn and provide to our clients what they need. So what's happening, what are the applications at the moment some of the banks are requiring, or the insurance and the insurance sector? So ownership, account balance, and inputs equals outputs, which is the most interesting, well, the most demanding application, well, something that it's required on the majority of the smart contracts. Membership, netting is a very